Mr. Krishna Kumar, thanks a lot for taking time out to join us. So I think you and from what I have read about your company and heard from others, your business model is also, I mean, it's about innovation only. And so you are doing something which has not been tried in Indian context as yet. So it will be good if you could share something about your company and the kind of innovation you are trying to bring about.
Okay, thanks. So I'm Kunal, basically. So my partner Krishna could not come and attend this event. So myself and Krishna co-founded this company 6 years back. I hope the presentation would have run and people would have talked about the bigger challenge that is coming, like 2050, there's the food scarcity that is there. But we see that bigger challenge as a very big opportunity. So if there is a bigger challenge, we can solve that bigger challenge with a bigger opportunity. If you see the trends as was shared, people, what we are doing is we are growing global average. India is like 30% of the global average. That means we can reach that global average. That means if we require food X, we can still produce 5X of food. Now, why is that food not getting produced? Or if that food is getting produced, why is it not getting consumed? Because of the lack of information. In this agri ecosystem, information plays a very vital and critical role. And there are organizations which are doing their jobs very fine. You see seed companies, they are excellent in building technologies on seed. They'll give you 5 times, 10 times the productivity. Agri input company, fertilizer companies, machinery companies, everyone is doing a great job. But as information, as technology, you see the research institution, they have so many practices on how to grow crops, which can give you a higher yield. But unfortunately, what is happening is this knowledge are getting localized. We as an information technology company are trying to bring this knowledge together and bring it to the help of the farmer. Invariably, we have started working with organizations, because when we start working with a farmer, it requires a huge resource, a huge infrastructure to go and reach out to that level. But then there are so many organizations which really wants to work with a farmer in the best possible way. So we have started integrating technologies with these players, be it the NGOs, FPOs, the governments, the private players. Everyone can make their systems and processes efficient and reach out the information to the end user, which is the farmer. So we are helping the farmers and the organization in both sense to connect to the information real time. That's more of a technology on a micro level. On a macro level technology, there are technologies where we're working on long-term weather forecasts. So if you talk about like last year, the last two seasons hasn't been bad, but now the weather predictions are saying that the rainfall is going to be 10% more and things like that. So if the weather is going to be good, what is the effect of the good weather on crops across India? So we can predict, so there's a lot of science across crops which we are also working. So we have worked with across 50 plus organizations, more than 5 lakh farmers. So we have a database which we can analyze and understand if last 3 years this was the weather pattern, and if this year this is the weather pattern, and the same practice is going to be followed, what is the effect on the output? And if the effect of the output is going to be higher, how it is getting consumed? So if we have those understanding much in advance, the people who are buying the produce, the people who are selling the, so if you see right now, if you go and talk to companies, everyone is just geared up. I will send more inputs, I'll send more seeds, I'll send more pesticides, I'll buy more output, because everyone is depending on the weather. And if you can predict that much in advance and work on those very closely, the actions that requires the critical information at the right time can be captured there. So we work a lot on those sides as well. Apart from that, we are also working on remote sensing, which is again a bigger picture, because micro level, if you talk about India, if you work with farmers, they are like 1/2 acre, 2 acre, 3 acres, whereas in US you'll have 100 acres, hectares of land. So when we want to do a micromanagement, it is very difficult. It requires intensive people. You need hundreds and thousands of people in your organization to go and reach out to people. Now, how can I do a job once and then know exactly what is happening on the crop across the season? So the remote sensing comes and plays a very critical role. It's a technology which is expensive right now, but you see so many technology in Germany, US, and other places where they are investing a lot, and it's going to be 10 times cheaper than what is right now. So we are investing not only in coming technology which is being utilized, we are also investing on future technology. The objective of the vision of our company is to make every farm traceable. We understand that farmer, the information of the farmer is like a gold mine. And if we encash that properly, if this information can be shared across to the right participant, it can make a billion dollar business and a great effect to the entire ecosystem as well. So that's what CropIt is doing, and that's our intent. Thanks.
Thanks. Thanks a lot, Kunal, for talking about your business model. I think that is traceability is something that is going to be extremely valuable going forward. People are talking about more and more about the responsible farming and eco-friendly farming, and I think having a technology like that, having a business built around that, is highly valuable. So thanks a lot for sharing the details of your business model. I'll come back to gentleman on my right, Mr. Mario. Welcome to India, and I have heard and read about your company, but it will be good if you could share something about the company and the kind of work that you guys are doing, and then also talk about some of the innovations that you have done in terms of your products and services and developing the business model around them.
Thank you. Before actually going into the company, I would like to speak very shortly about Sri Lanka and agriculture. I mean, we have been quite lucky because 3,000 years ago our forefathers first started harvesting rain, and we have been very good at protecting our water and using it in agriculture and other purposes. For example, the recent Mahavadi scheme in 1977 is now producing, the land coming under Mahavadi is producing about 30% of the fresh produce eaten around the country. Something else that will work for us in the future is that our population growth is going to be rather flat, from something like 20.6 million, it will probably grow to about 20.8 by 2020. However, we are projecting ourselves as a tourist destination and expecting to have 10 million tourists, which is doubling the amount of people wanting food, and at a different level of the type of food we are producing right now. So that's the big challenge. Let us look at the ground situation. The big four crops that we have in the country, only two are essential crops. We have tea, rubber, coconut and rice. So it's only coconut and rice that are essential crops. Tea and rubber are open to huge fluctuations depending, for instance, in the Middle East, the oil market has gone down. Tea and rubber are both hit because people move away from natural rubber and the Arabs are not drinking as much tea as they used to. So that's our dilemma. However, there is also an opportunity because intercropping, which we have now started working on, where the large estates, where there is abundance of labor, and also we have land spaces available where we can do intercropping, and that's probably one of the ways we can move into the future. Also, the use of technology. I think our case is very similar to what all these gentlemen were talking about. Affordability is a big problem, and the other one is also the knowledge base. Of course, all these things are driven by, I would say, one very important thing, and that is the politicization of agriculture in Sri Lanka. It's a huge problem for us. You see, nobody is willing to take up any activity because it's a very important political subject, and usually the government gets involved. Very recently we saw people running behind fertilizer companies and closing down stores and things like that. Now, having said that, the government started giving our farmers free fertilizer, and what we have ended up with is a huge medical bill coming from kidney diseases due to the overuse and the waterways getting polluted. So it's very difficult now. The current government is trying to change this into at least a cash grant, so that the farmers have a choice of what extent they would use this money to. And this is becoming a huge problem in Sri Lanka, and hopefully it will work for us. because I can't imagine tourists wanting to come and eat, you know, food with huge levels of chemical residues and things like that. Then going to our company. We are a medium-sized company. However, right from the beginning, one of the reasons why I was a typical middle class in Colombo, and my father used to work for British American Tobacco, and suddenly after retirement he thought he'd go into the new frontiers, which is the Mavali areas, to open up a trading business. And while doing that, of course, he was never a businessman and the business didn't do quite well. And I went up to help him and I said, okay, there is something nice here, let me stay. I was also not a business person, but enjoyed the open environment and what was happening. And what I saw was thousands of farmers, small farmers, creating produce with no proper value chains. And there was an opportunity to actually design products that will create value for them. And on the other side, look at markets, because we were more tapped into markets, and to create products that will create value for the consumers. So we just basically are a company that designs products and brands that create value for the farmers. And at the same time, we use this leverage to actually move this value and also get farmers to be more environmental friendly, to be more sustainable in their work, and also focus on things like education for their kids, benefits if they are injured and things like that, where we channel this, the value we create into these areas so that we give them better possibilities of an equitable life. Now, technology is one way that we have also tried to do this, where we have trial farm, where we bring in people and work with certain places. And also this access to funds. There was a time in Sri Lanka that not even 50% of funds for small farmers was dispersed within the period of time. And then some of us companies, we got together and we told the government, look, we can facilitate this. And it was very simple, because the bank managers know us. So we go down to the fields, we send our extension officers, talk to the guys, create their business plan, take it to the bank manager and actually negotiate on their behalf. And it costs us nothing, and in the future we have a supply. So we leverage that connectivity into supplying us organic certified products and more sustainable agriculture. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Mr. Mario. Very interesting observations and very interesting business model. I'll reach out to Jinesh now, the only investor on the panel. One of the very common, as an investment banker, one of the most common complaint I had against the investors was that they don't understand. Very few of them actually understand agriculture. Some of them might understand technology, and when you combine the two, agriculture and technology, the situation was almost hopeless. And here we have somebody who specializes in investing in agri-technology companies. My question to you is very simple. How do you manage to do that? Because a technology can be a breakthrough technology. And innovation can be, you know, really far, with it might have far-reaching implications. But, and as most of the other panelists would understand, commercializing an innovation is a huge challenge. So how exactly do you marry the two, innovations and technology, with the commercialization of that?
Thanks, Abdul. Good afternoon, everyone. I mean, we are an ag-tech focused fund. None of us are an agriculture fund. I mean, we all come from varied backgrounds. But what we have realized that technology remains technology. It's how you apply it. That's the basic thesis we go about it. So we specialize in few areas within agriculture. One is what we like is precision agriculture and IoT, big data, that's one area. Second is sustainability. we think there will be ways and means where you can find alternate to the existing ways how crop has been sowed or how its crops crop production has happened. Third area is what we look is innovative food companies which has a potential to have impact on the usage of energy, usage of supply chain issues, problems we have it. And the other area what we look is financial technologies and water management technologies. So we know a bit about the areas what we've been doing about it. And as a fund, whenever we get a proposal, I mean we try to understand what the farmer does it, right? I mean lot of people come out with a proposal saying that we want to do something but for farmers, and if it's seen that it's only a marginal improvement, we would tend to avoid that. We think if there is a way we can transform the lives of farmers out of this, we would take a leap of faith in that. It's quite a challenging one. I mean, things like Skymet weather, which we invested first. I mean, I didn't know a shit about weather, right? I mean, I just knew rains came and rains didn't came, right? I mean, but trying to understand how you measure the weather with sensors, how you reduce the cost of sensors, and how you can get weather data which is more granular than what the IMD for the last 100 years was providing made us find something interesting. We also realized that weather is a way to get into insurance, weather is a way to get into financial services, weather is a way to get into stock markets, because a lot of things work around it, and this is the reason we started looking into Skymet, right? We knew a bit about weather, but we always look around a holistic system. I mean, companies like Stellas, I mean, these are five engineers from Pro Technologies who no one had an agriculture background, but they created the first IoT company in the world for dairy farmers having 10 cows, 15 cows, 5 cows. And what they did was understood the entire value chain, how a cow's milk should be done, and they figured out how you increase the lactation cycle of cow's milk. It's very simple in logic. But it takes that if you have 2 to 6 crore farmers or 60 million farmers who are in the dairy business owning on an average 2 cows, 3 cows, and make them use that without telling them how to use it. Like, technology is such a beautiful thing that it don't require any knowledge about it. You just ask the farmer, switch on the machine, it should work. It should work seamlessly, and that's how they will create that. So it's a process. We also learning the road. I don't think there is an answer. We generally don't do anything which is non-tech. I think out of the portfolio of 11 companies that are running to what we're doing, there's only one non-tech company which we have done. And we prefer to work saying that as a VC, if 50% of my companies do great, I'll make a lot of money. I'll create more impact than a lot of efforts by the government, NGOs can do around it. And I think entrepreneurs are awesome, right? I mean, people like Kunal and Rotash can do something great, we're just helping them out and say, guys, let's we give you a push and see what comes out.
Not yet.
So I'll move to Mr. Madhu now, because we have looked at lots of, we know that innovations are happening. The toughest part comes, and that comes to entrepreneurs, because they need to convert those innovations into an effective business model, commercializing the innovation. And that's the toughest part in the entire, process of making the innovation useful. So from you, I would like to understand the challenges that as an entrepreneur you face in bringing a completely new concept to the market and making it work.
There is this, the Chinese have a solution to this problem. It says if you want to make money, follow the money trail. So where does the money begin from, right? So whatever you do, the coin rolls back from the consumer. The last mile is the most complex mile. Now, for example, what Jen is doing is essentially if you take away fruits, vegetables, tissue cultures, etc., etc., Jen irrigation, and I have watched you for the last 8 years, is the last mile company.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
So until you have the last pipe into the oil well, whatever pumps you have up there, that is going to come. So the most complex piece in this jigsaw puzzle is the creation of the last mile. Now let's talk about the machines that investments that Jinesh is making, or Kropin talking about technologies. And you actually Kunal, right? Kunal actually referred to it right early in his conversations. We prefer to work with large farmers or large aggregates. Why is that?
The last mile.
Because somebody, you want to ride on somebody's last mile, which is a very wise way of doing it. Complexity number one, get the last mile right. Complexity two, you can't do it out of the 26th floor of Nariman Point, some Nariman Point village. You've got to be right there. So if you want to pump out water, you've got to be right there next to the well. There's no other way of doing it. And as far as I'm concerned, that's the sum total of the gap about getting water out of a well. You just got to be there. Now, a few lesser complexities. When you get to the ground, it goes back to my days of building telecom networks 15 years, 16 years ago. The complexities of dealing with, in that time, or dealing with politicians, cops, local MLAs, was far greater than the technology. That, I mean, what's there in an optic fiber, you just shove it into the ground, some machine does it, all you have to do is manage some contractors and they'll take care of it, put a tower, put a transmitter up there, you've got a telecom network. I spent 80% of my time managing the environment. So when you go down to where oil is, you're going to disturb something that has been in existence for 50-100 years. There is an economic system in situ, and that has its own balance of power with the local environment. And you are there with a stone making a ripple, and you've got to be able to manage that thing, right? Take remote areas where there's no electricity. You've got handheld devices to move money, right? But for a couple of kilometers, there's no signal, right? So how do you move money out of there? Firstly, cash is a problem. But how do you move electronic money when there is no signal, right? So I can go on and on, but the fact is, that mile is the most rewarding mile in the entire thing. What are we doing at EM3? We're building a platform there. So you want to pass through consumer credit, crop insurance, even satellite services. I'm sitting right there as your distributor to carry it to the farm. Right? So in a very overall sense, we are the last mile. And that is, we chose the toughest part of the piece so that without this piece we reckoned, technologies were unavailable, approaches were available, money was available, but building the last mile was the key. And to me, that is the sum total of the challenge.
So essentially, identifying the value chain in the best possible
the side.
And go for the toughest side and manage the environment. I mean, that's the...
Manage the environment is a different thing, but go for the toughest part of the value chain. If you can crack that, you get a disproportionate share of the value creation.
That I think is the key takeaway.
I mean, at the end of the day, with due respect to Kunal, and I mean, if I own the last mile, then I'll choose which service provider I want to carry.
Absolutely.
So this comes from the telecom system. Right? If you own the optic fiber, then you can choose what to carry on it.